Wow, that track is a jam.
Juro and Tell. Excellent, excellent chip composer. Very well known for compositions in Commodore 64 games. And going along with our theme, as we typically do at the beginning of these streams, we've picked a chiptune from a game with the word computer, tech, or Apple in the title of the game or in the title of the tune, and this is a track from Technocop.
Music 03. Hi, Breakin. Good morning, Simon. Long time no see, folks. How are you entities doing tonight? Briggan says, so Red doesn't want to talk about it, but are you a fan of the Voyager Wacky Warp 10 episode? I think that that episode is not particularly good, but I think that it gets... I think there are far worse episodes of Star Trek than that. That one's just goofy, but there are other Star Trek episodes that are infuriating or worse in other ways, I feel. But, not a great episode. I think so, Simon. I'd have to get back to you on the specifics, but I definitely have had stronger feelings about other Trek episodes in different series. I also think Spock's brain gets way, way too much vitriol as well. I think that they just became poster children episodes to make fun of, I think. All right, folks, let's do it. St. John. Nerd Noise Radio. No, the Tuvix episode is also good. The Tuvix episode is a fantastic ethical conundrum. That's a great episode. IMHO. Oh, you're not saying it's bad. You're saying it was two separate episodes fused together. My goodness. Can you tell that I'm like, my finger's on the trigger to defend the Tuvix episode all the time? That's a great, great episode, I think. Ethical conundrums, that's what good sci-fi does. It's true. It's true. So, how are you all doing tonight? St. John Nerd Noise Radio, it's really good to see you. How are things? Riggins says, I veered into dangerous territory here. You can't stay long, Nerd Noise Radio. You've got major show work to do. Oh, well, that's really sweet. Thanks for dropping in. I hope that your major show work goes smoothly. You've got quite a crunch time going on, but I believe in you. I know you can do it. I know you've handled crunch times before. Simon says, I'm excited. I don't know what I'm going to walk away with after this stream, but it'll probably be fun. Kakalakala! Ahoy hoy! I really love saying kakalakala. Kakalakala! Lip! Hey hey! What's up? Oh, folks, you're all filtering in. This is so sweet. So... Alright, on a couple of previous Apple IIsday streams, we've been doing some text-heavy stuff. Last week we did a bunch of kind of random little games like Spy Hunter, Fat City, you know, very kind of short and sweet games. So I thought maybe tonight we would delve into another Microzine game. So to refresh your memory, Microzine was the scholastic periodical that came with educational games and kind of, I guess what you would call mini games at this point. So each of these had like one or two showstopper big programs and then other little things around. So I thought we would delve into one of the showstopper programs that was not text heavy. And this one actually involves a timer and a section that really freaked me out as a kid. And I haven't played this since, I don't know, maybe I was in my early teens. I don't know the last time I beat it. I definitely beat it as a child, but I can't remember the last time I did so. I don't know if I did it as a teenager. I used to have this whole approach to it, but we're going to be playing off of Microzine 13. We are going to be playing the game featured in the artwork here, The Frog and the Fables, A Magical Story. So, we're going to get that going. And then I'm gonna catch up with all of you. We're gonna have to fade out this amazing music. So good. Dro and Tell. So good. That's a Rob F. Switch tune, right? Nerd Noise Radio. If any of you listen to the Legacy Music Hour, I feel like that has Rob F. Switch written all over it.
Bum, 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 bum. All right. Getting myself set up over here. I don't need the headphones anymore. Also, folks, this is kind of strange. I haven't had my headphones off in the Apple II stream, I think, in a little while since this has happened, but I don't know if any of you noticed that I had an earring in this ear, like a captured, I think they're called captured ball rings, the sort of ring ones that you get with piercings in your cartilage. I had to remove it recently for a procedure. I'm fine, but I couldn't have any jewelry on me. And I had not taken that thing out since I originally got it when I was 18. So I'd had that in and never removed it for like 15 years. So it's very weird. It's very weird to have a naked left ear. And I find myself, when I'm doing things in public, I've realized that touching it was a nervous habit, because sometimes I've been talking to someone and I've been feeling a little shy about, like, excuse me, do you have... And I reach for it and it's not there. So I gotta get another one and put it in. That's on my list of things to do. So, side story apropos of nothing. Enjoy it. Enjoy this clean view of my left ear. So, Microzine, let's do it. And let me read to you about the frog and the fables. So again, I'll always show you the inside. You open up this beautiful case. You have the manual tucked away in there. And the frog and the fables is a twist-a-plot adventure, much like the haunted house one that we were doing earlier, but it's a very different kind of spin on it, and I think it's really cool. So here's what they say about The Frog and the Fables, a twist-a-plot adventure. Once there was a frog who always threw away his Microzine handbook. What? One day he was using the exciting twist-a-plot, The Frog and the Fables, when the evil wizard Oxon suddenly appeared. The frog was so flustered he forgot which computer keys to press. The frog searched in vain for his Microzine handbook, but it was too late. Oxen turned him into a green data disk. Moral: never throw away your handbook, even if you are a frog. Okay, that's just a weird little... That's their own little fable about reading the manual, not throwing away the manual. Very important. What you'll find: you will travel through a forest and search a palace for fables. The sun, the animals in the forest, and the statues in the palace will help you in your search. You must match the fables to the correct morals before the sand in your magical hourglass runs out. Okay, moving your figure. In this twist-a-plot, you are the figure below. Use the arrow keys to move around. Magical hourglass. The Frog King will ask you if you want to take his magical hourglass. Type yes, blah, blah, blah. As long as there is sand in the top of the hourglass, you will be safe from Oxon. You must find the fables and match them to the morals before the sand runs out. Searching the palace. You will search the palace for hidden fables. The fables are in rooms that have statues of the king's courtiers. By listening to the statues, you will know whether or not there is a fable in the room. If you think there is a fable hidden in the room, type S to search. If the statue uses correct grammar, it is telling the truth, of course. It's how we always tell who's telling the truth. For example, if a statue says there is no fable behind the curtain, so don't waste your time, you will know that there really is no fable hidden behind the curtain, because the statue used correct grammar. If a statue uses incorrect grammar, you will know that it is really Oxon in disguise. Oxon will lie to you to make you waste your time or to trick you into not searching a room that really has a fable. Always do the opposite of what he says. If you search a room where there is no fable, you will waste valuable time. I promise this will make more sense when we actually do it. Okay, when you find a fable... Now I actually have to read this to remember how this works. When you find a fable, press return to place it in the Book of Fables. The first page of the fable will appear in the top half of the screen. Type P to go to the next page. The first of the four possible morals for that fable will appear at the bottom of the screen. Moral chosen. If you change your mind. Okay, Okay, sorry, there's a lot more of this than I thought. Okay, so it's teaching me how to do this. There are four versions of this twist-a-plot. In each version, the animals are in different parts of the forest, and the king's study and wizard's workshop are in different rooms in the palace. Four of the 14 fables in this twist-a-plot will appear randomly in the different versions. Okay. bum 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 bum. Okay, that's all that.
Hey, radioactive man from Mars. How are you? Welcome to this other part of Earth. I hope you're doing all right. Radioactive man from Mars is here on work business. On Earth, apparently. They were in my No Man's Sky stream last night. That was really fun. So, this is a very different kind of stream, Radioactive Man. Specs, lurking again! Specs, I say hello to the room. I will not make direct eye contact with you, just in case that makes you uncomfortable. Feel free to lurk away. But it's nice to know that you're out there. So that was a whole lot of reading the manual, which was important, but let's just launch right on into the Frog and the Fables now, and hopefully this will all come back to us. I remember basically how the game works. It's maybe the very specific keystrokes that I might need to kind of think about, but otherwise I think we're good. You remember this, Radioactive Man? Did you have microzines? That's super exciting if you did. Oh, and again, I'm playing on an amber monitor, so I get to see it in beautiful color over there. The Frog and the Fables by Jeffrey Siegel. You are about to enter a twist-a-plot adventure. Do you want instructions? Let's just do the instructions. Your school did, so I did all the good things that got me computer time. Oh, so you were a star student because you wanted to get computer time? What a motivator. That's a great motivator. That's really cool that your school had them. When I was in school, it was kind of beyond the heyday of the Apple II, so these weren't just hanging around in school. We did have in each classroom until I was in maybe third grade, there was an Apple II in the back of a lot of classes, just one computer, with the classics like number munchers and stuff, so that students could use those sometimes. And I used one of the Apple IIs in the back of one of my classes because I moved rooms in one grade and didn't. I took lessons in two different grades, and so sometimes in one room I would be stuck there during a lesson that I wasn't really supposed to be paying attention to because I was supposed to go to another class for that subject. And during those times when I couldn't go to the other class because they weren't teaching the subject I needed, but the class I was in was teaching the subject that I didn't need, I would get to play the Apple II in the back of the room to pass time, if that makes sense. All right, in The Frog and the Fables, you will walk through a forest and meet animals. Use these keys to move. Yes. That's right. I always think that the 2 plus was more advanced than the 2e or 2c, but I don't think that that's true. But plus just seems more advanced to me. But we have arrow keys. Very fancy. The Renaissance, hello! The Renaissance, you really are everywhere tonight. How are you doing? Are you getting ready to launch soon? The Renaissance is starting a new game tonight. If you don't follow the Renaissance, please do so. He's quite an enjoyable human being. He's a very good earthling radioactive man from Mars, so I think you could learn a lot from him about our culture. And he's a stellar example of a human being. So, and he is all over the joint tonight. I've seen you in a bunch of chats. New games, says Brigand. Yes. All right. Helpful hints for playing the Frog and the Fables. Listen to everything the Frog has to tell you before you move on. When asked a question, type in your answer and then press return. Make a map as you move and mark down where you meet animals. I never made a map. It's even telling me to. I had a system of how I would go about, so I'm not going to map, and we're going to see how it goes. If I could hold it in my head when I was 9, I think I can hold it in my head when I'm 34, yeah. What are we... We're not creating anything tonight, the Renaissance. We're playing one of the big highlight games on a Microzine disc, which is actually trying to cram as many learning opportunities as it can into one game. We have to worry about grammar, we have to know morals of fables, we have to read everything that we're told, and so on and so forth. So they're really trying to make it a teachable moment at every turn. The gnarled fox was our creative peak. I kept that. I have it. I have that, and I don't think... I actually put it kind of behind me. I have a little tiny little filing cabinet where I keep the most important pieces of paper to me, just one filing cabinet of like drawings I've done and childhood memories, the gnarled fox card went in there. It went in to my most important collection of treasured papers. So I want you all to know that and how much I love you. Okay. Write down any information the animals give you. Keep a list of the items the animals give you. Most animals will repeat what they told you if you go away and then see them again. Here is a list of all the creatures you will meet in the forest. I think these designs are really cool. These designs, for some reason, have just always sort of stayed in my head. They really stood out to me as a kid. A frog, a hare, a crow, a bear, a sun, a dog, and the wizard. Yes, creatures. A wizard is not an animal. A wizard is an animal. If a wizard is a human, it's an animal. But if it's like Gandalf and, you know, is one of those higher creatures, then... Hey, Popo! Oh my god, more Apple II! Welcome, Apple IIsday! Musty Hobbit, did I hear Gandalf? You've been summoned by talk of Lord of the Rings. Yes, you did! We were discussing that Gandalf is not a man, but we don't know if this wizard is in fact a human being. Popo, Musty, how are we doing tonight? Sun, I see? Question mark? St. John, I hope you're not typing while you're driving. Oh god, the colors on this font is awful. So this happens with text in on the Apple II, and it has something to do with whether or not you have text or images. If you have text only, it will be white, but if you have text and graphics on screen at the same time, or the text is a graphic, it will often have this weird kind of bleeding, blending green purple thing. There's a really interesting video on the internet that explains why this happens programming wise. Popo, you might actually be really interested to check that out. I'll have to find it for you. It's really interesting. Musty says, well, I stayed up a little late last night. Kakalakala says, which brings up the question, who else might show up if Tingle is mentioned? Uh-oh, we did it. We put it out into the universe. Alright, they all have something important for you, so try to find them all before entering the palace. That's very important. Do you want to read the instructions again? No, I've got it, thank you. Oh, you were going for a Sun and Sonic portmanteau. Nice. Sun-ick. Simon says, I thought the color merging had to do with combining multiple graphics modes. It's something like that. I forget the specifics. Mr. Popo, no, I just did. Popo, you came late. You came late. We already read the instructions. We read the printed instructions, and we read the digital instructions, so we're all over this jank. This is a pod person pretending to be key. I know. That's how you all tell, Popo, that is so true. Folks, if I'm ever on stream, and I'm, like, playing a game, and I'm like, I don't know what I'm doing, and you're all like, did you read the manual yet? And I'm like, no. That's when you call the police. It's not me. I've been replaced. Oh, really? Did Ak put me in another game? No. He put me in a different... Did he play a different Might and Magic and I was a sorceress or something? I was a sorceress in one of his games. That's pretty cool. I'll have to check that out. Thank you for tipping me off. Popo is from a retro gaming forum that I frequent called racketboy.com, and Ak is another person from Racket Boy. And when Ak plays games that require you to pick a party, he will often give them names of other Racket Boys and then update us all on our adventures and what's happened to us. So that's cool. I can't wait to see if I get my head bitten off again like last time. Alright, so Frog in the Fables, here we go. Once upon a time, in your neighbor's yard. I'm going to plant a garden, your neighbor says, but to make room, I'm going to have to cut down your favorite tree. Wow, this is actually hitting me in the feels because this kind of happened when I was growing up. What? You cry? I just finished building my treehouse up there. Okay, I didn't have a treehouse. Now, wait a minute. Our neighbor is going to cut down our favorite tree that we have a treehouse in, so this is already very complicated. Did our neighbor let us build a treehouse in their tree?
Are they encroaching on our property? Is it joint property? We're just going to go with it, but wow, so many questions right off the bat. Popo, that's awesome. I've been the all-star. Nice. I'm just smiting people left and right with holy promise. Sorry, your neighbor says. I have to go to the hardware store now to rent a power saw. You look up at the treehouse and kick the tree. Ah, I didn't like that old treehouse anyway. This is not very in character for me. I'd be very upset about the tree being cut down, and I wouldn't kick it. We're taking out our anger on the wrong target here. Just as you're about to leave, you see something in the grass. It's a little green frog. Slowly you kneel down and grab the frog between your cupped hands. Oh, thank you, Coca-Cola. Coca-Cola, I think links are turned on in my chat right now, so if you have the link, please feel free to drop it in. Yes, because I believe that's the video that I watched. And it was really good. But you have my permission. You open your hands a crack to peek in, but the frog jumps out. Just as it lands on the ground, you blink, and when your eyes open, you see that the yard has changed. Suddenly, it's filled with tall trees. Your neighbor's house is far away now, and it looks like a castle. Where am I? You wonder aloud. The frog looks up at you with intelligent eyes and says, "Hey, pro KFL. Cool to see someone showing real games. thank you for the compliment. I like to imagine that you looked at every single streaming on Twitch, and you were like, these aren't real games. But welcome to the chat. How are you doing today? Are you an Apple II fan? You're in Fabulon. That's a great name. The land where fables come from. And now that you are here, I have a desperate request to make. Will you help me fight the evil wizard, Oxon, and regain my throne?" I don't know that I've ever said no. I actually want to see what happens. Let's test all of our options, shall we? Because we'll just restart the game if we get tossed out. I would love it if it games over on us. Hey, 8-Bit Aslan, what's up? Ermagerg, that 2E! You're a retro computer nerd, you could say. I will say. Well, that's fantastic. We are on my childhood Apple IIe, which still runs wonderfully. We've got two disk drives. I wish I could show it to you. Maybe I should do that. I'm always afraid to move the camera because, you know. But why don't we just do this? Let's give you all a good look at what my setup is right here. Here we go. Do-do-do-do-do-do. That's my CRT over there where I play retro games, but here's the Apple II. There's our joystick and our two drives. Amber monitor. Here's how I keep up with what all of you are saying. It fits so perfectly right there. So that's the Apple II that has survived so many years and given me such wonderful service. So that's about right? We're good? We're good. Wow, you have a bunch, Pro. That's really cool. I've only ever had the 2E. I don't think I've even... Well, I might have used other Apple IIs, but that would have been in a public library. I'd never had a friend that had one. Kitarito! Evening, humans! How are ya? Oh, 8-Bit Aslan, I've got summer games. I've got a cracked copy of summer games and winter games that will definitely be being played on a future Apple IIsday for sure. Loved those games. So good. Didn't have Ghostbusters or Black Cauldron, though. But summer games, fantastic. So let's see what happens if we say no. The end. Press return to continue or escape to quit. On my honor, I beseech you, will you please help me? No. Press return to hear more, use the arrow keys to move or escape to quit. Well, very well then, scoundrel, be on your selfish way. But remember that I warned you of the evil wizard Oxon. Good day, rogue! Whoa! It let us do it! We're gonna start over and do it the right way, because I'm feeling personally very bad about
So I can't live with myself. So we're going to quit the game. And we're going to start it again. But that's amazing that they actually wrote in those options. It wasn't... You ever play video games where you can say no, and a character will just be like, do you really mean that? Do you really mean that? And they'll just keep giving you the same canned dialogue of like, but please help. But please help. But please help. Okay. Let's start over with the same fables. Why not? Pizzerito is doing good. Getting your new phone configured, so lurk away. Simon says, look, I just met you. I bet if I walk down the road, I'm going to find four more magical creatures who say it's their throne. And yeah, why am I trusting this frog? All right, so again, we're in Fabulon. Yes, we will help you regain your throne. I am grateful, stranger, and I offer you this magical hourglass. It will protect you from Oxon as long as there is sand in the top half of it. Do you want the hourglass? Yes. There it is. So this game's on a timer. This actually, that hourglass runs down. So there's a stress factor here. Good, because this hourglass is magical. It will protect you from Oxon, the evil wizard. As long as there is still sand in it, Oxon cannot harm you. The last frog I met always lied. What makes you different? That's very bigoted against frogs. We're better people than that. Let me tell you my story. I used to be king when I had the magical Book of Fables. Oxon wanted to be king, but the book's magic was stronger than his evil powers. One day, Oxon summoned a wind out of the north. It roared through the window of my study and scattered the pages of the magical Book of Fables. Oxon ran into the room and gathered up the scattered pages. Then he turned me into a frog and turned all my courtiers into statues. I hopped into the woods to escape. I know, the Renaissance. This happens to everybody, doesn't it? Look, we're already running out of sand. The longer we take to read, the more sand runs out. There's an extra pixel that's already fallen. The animals in the woods want to help me become king again, but we need a human to go into the palace and get the book. You really must help us. You see, you're a prisoner now, too. Oxon won't let you leave Fabulon, and sooner or later he'll turn you into a statue or an animal or who knows what. So, before the sand runs out of the hourglass, go and talk with the animals. They'll tell you how to get the book, and when you get it, bring it back here. Good luck. All right, off we go. Okay, I don't think it keeps logging my keystrokes, so it's not going to move me indefinitely. So here we go, on our way. Here he is. If we hadn't taken the hourglass, remember when the frog was saying, you're a scoundrel? We would have gamed over right here, because we wouldn't have been protected from Oxon. I kind of regret not doing that now. Ha! This is Oxon, and I says you are trespassing on my land. For this, I thinks I will turn you into a donkey, or a statue. Ha! A statue of a donkey! Razzum dazzum schmaz! Schmaz. That's a version of sauce, the Renaissance. Schmaz. You must have gotten that hourglass from the Frog King. Haha. Okay. So you have a little time, but you will never succeed, and soon you wills be my prisoner forever. Haha. Alright. So my system for doing this in the past was to basically go down the columns and make sure that I went down each one to find all of the animals. So let's start here. Oh, it's a dead end. Well, not a dead end, but that's it for this column. We need a YouTube series. Key reads fantasy novels to children. Razzum, dazzum, schmaz. Let's check this out. Is there anything up here? Nope. Alright, so far nothing. Oksana Bayul. Wow, I watched a lot of figure skating growing up. That's really funny. That's right from my prime ice skating watching days, Oksana Bayul. Michelle Kwan. Oh man, stuff off to the right. Hey, it's the dog. Oh, so that's the entrance to the palace. I cannot let you into the palace without the morals. Find Aunt Bear. She has the morals. Okay. Oh, press return to hear more. There's no more to hear. Okay. So after we get the fables and we go back to the frog, then we're going to go into the palace. So we know where that is. 8-bit says, I barely watched any skating, but that was when I watched the most. So same, I guess. That was something that my whole family did together. We watched figure skating. Even, you know, off-season stuff, we would watch the competitions that weren't for major things, necessarily. Hey, Rooney Gamer, what's up? We are playing another Microzine, and we're playing the Frog and the Fables game off of Microzine number 13. Eight-bit, I feel you are not serious. Aha, here we go. Hello, are you? Oh yes, I am Ms. Hare. Now, oh, before I forget, I have been to the palace, and guess what? Oh yes, the Good King's study is room 1. Remember that number. Remember that number. If you enter that room, oh yes, the hourglass will be refilled. Yes, how wonderful. You will be protected from that wicked wizard for a longer period of time. Room 1. But the hourglass can only be refilled once, so go to the king's study only when you really need to. Good luck now. Good day. Room 1. Thank you, Rooney. You're like, if I were a teacher, it would be like, somebody remember that. Rooney, you remember room 1. That rabbit had some personality in that dialogue, for sure. You just wanted to seem edgy, 8-bit. Alright. Bright enough for you today? No. Could be brighter. Oh well, I'll try harder. Good day. Okay, let's go back. Have you tried harder since I last saw you? Bright enough for you today? Yeah, you're doing... I see some improvement. Yeah, the sun is quite an interesting design. Ah, that warms me to hear that. I hear that you want to recover the Book of Fables and bring it back to the Frog King. That's very brave of you, but it won't be easy. You see, Oxon took all the pages with morals on them and threw them out a window. The morals scattered with the wind. Old Aunt Bear went and collected each moral. She still has them. So, to get the book back, you'll first have to get the morals from Aunt Bear. She's somewhere in the woods. I feel like Mother Nature gave me some honey for Aunt Bear. Do you want to take it to her? Yes. Video game logic tells me yes, then I'm probably going to have to trade that. Good. Here it is. Now get hot on the trail of Aunt Bear and find those morals. Yeah, it does kind of look like the Super Mario Brothers 3 son. Yeah. Okay, so I think we're back at the top. I really liked the term sow cow. I thought that was really funny. Because as a kid, I didn't realize how it was spelled, so I thought it was sow cow, like sow pig cow. I thought that was kind of funny. I was like, why would they call it a sow cow? Good flying camel. I never liked the death spiral. I always would get kind of concerned. Hey, it's the crow. Caw, caw! I am Mr. Crow. Listen closely. One room in the palace is the wizard's workshop. It is room 4. Remember this number. Who's gonna remember 4 for me? Never enter this room. The evil magic is too strong there. If you enter, you will be turned into a statue. Now go and beware the evil that is Oxon. Okay. Renaissance? Good. Thank you. Four? Workshop? Good. Thank you for volunteering. So we want to go leftwards when we can. If we can. No. Because we've only been one column to the left or right. And we came up this way. So let's keep on moving. Schmaz! Okay, here we go. So we're going to want to go left. I will remember that number. I remember. Let's go this way. All right. Ant Bear? Yes! Thank you so much for the honey. Now we can have our tea. And here are the morals. But before you run away, be still and listen. That villain Oxon hid the fables throughout the palace, so you will have to go to the palace to find them. Once the fables and the morals are matched together and the Book of Fables is complete, the magic will return. You will be saved, and the fair king will rule again. Here are the morals. Now be on your way. So we... Oh, whoop, 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 whoop. I hit the wrong arrow. We have the morals. And we're going to bring them back to the frog, but I just really quickly want to see what is, you'll have to hurry and find those fables, you're running out of time. Oh, wait. I think we bring the book back to the frog, and then each of the animals in the forest is going to have a different fable, so we're going to have to pick each one up. So let's go back to the frog. Irini Gamer says, oh geez, sorry to show up and run so quickly, but I think your lack of sleep is catching up with you quicker than you expected. So sorry. Enjoy the apple. Don't be sorry. Thank you for dropping in. Please sleep well. I hope you catch up on all the sleep that you need. Do you think my character's wearing a baseball hat? I mean, it's not snowy out, but I'm sort of seeing, like, earmuffs. I'm seeing an earmuff situation on this character. No. Good day. Did any of you... Alright, I need to tell you all something. I watched Blue's Clues way beyond the point when I should have. I was way too old to be watching Blue's Clues, but what I loved about Blue's Clues... This is going somewhere, I swear. What I loved about Blue's Clues was that when you found each clue... there would be a line of music with it, so it would be a channel, like a particular instrument, or drums or something, and when all three clues got put together, it would be kind of a full song. So, I loved that. I just wanted to always hear the song as it kind of progressed. But, there's an episode where they talk about the planets, and the sun sings a song, and I loved that song. It was so funny. So I kind of think of the sun in this game as being that same sun. It was sort of a jazzy tune about the solar system, and it was really good. I'll sing it eventually. So, wait a minute. Oh, wait. Did she just give us the book? I think she just gave us the book, and now we have to get all the fables from the animals, right? Uh-oh. This is why we read the directions. I thought I would bring the book back and then get more time, so we gotta hustle. Or we'll just do it again. Hey, J-Rod, what's up? We may just wind up playing again because we are so out of time right now. How are you doing, J-Rod? You're seeing a little Commander Keen? This is the wrong way. Oh, no, it's not. The crow. Okay. Caw, caw, Mr. Crow. No, wait a minute. Okay, so I must have to go back to the frog. Or does the frog mean come back? Okay, so I'm a little bit confused because the frog just gave me the same dialogue that they had at the beginning of the game. So I'm gonna go check out the palace and see if... Oh, we are so out of time. We're so out of time. I thought we were gonna go... We're dead. Ha! Too bad for you, but all the sands has run out of your hourglass. You is now powerless. Bum bum bum! Ha, let me see. Shall I turn you into a donkey or a statue? Yes, a statue of a donkey. Ha, you wills forever be a statue. Try to move now. You is powerless. Ha, you my prisoner now for all time. Ha ha. Alright, so, yeah, we're like a unicorn donkey. At least that's cool. Okay, so, we're going to start over with the same fables, and I'm going to try to remember what step I'm missing here. This is what we call stream brain. It's either that I have to, because I thought my hourglass got replenished. It gets replenished at some point, but I thought it happened before I went into the palace. So my kind of childhood memories are conflicting, so, okay. We're in Fabulon. We will help you regain your throne. So let's really see what this frog is saying. I want the hourglass, yes. Okay, Oxon cannot harm me when I have the hourglass. Excellent. Okay. Oxen's magic was stronger. Oh, I think the frog was probably telling us at the end of the game, come back to me. But I don't remember doing that. So I need to stop relying on my old memories and just try to do it in the present. Okay, scattered the pages to the Book of Fables. Do you folks do that? Sometimes you go back to a game that you played as a kid and you are like trying to play it the way you think you used to and you've gotten your memories jumbled up after 15 years. Okay. So I need to just let go of what I think happens. But we need a human to go into the palace and get the book. You really must help us. You're a prisoner now, too. He's gonna turn, or who knows what. I know what. A statue of a donkey. So before the sand runs out of the hourglass, go talk with the animals. They'll tell you how to get the book. And when you get it, bring it back here. Good luck. Okay. So I think everybody's going to be in the same place. Since we didn't ask for new fables, everything should be the same place. Razzum dazzum schmazz! This wizard terrified me as a child. Alright. Razzum dazzum schmazz. Whenever he popped up, I would be so freaked out. Oh, so the song about the sun, or the song that the sun sings in Blue's Clues, went something like this. Well, the sun's a hot star, do-do-do-do-do-do-do, Mercury's hot too, do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do, Venus is the brightest planet, Earth's home to me and you, Mars is the red one, Jupiter's most wide, Saturn's got those icy rings. Uranus spins on its side. Neptune's really windy. And Pluto's really small. So you wanted to name the planets, and now we've named them all. I love that tune. Okay. That sun wore sunglasses, so this one just seems to have very deep-set eyes, but we'll say that they're wearing sunglasses also. Okay. Jupiter is most wide. The biggest. Hey, Vernon T, what up? Okay, I'll need to get the morals. So I'm getting the morals from Aunt Bear. I do want to take the honey.
So let's go find Aunt Bear again. Do you folks say aunt or aunt? I grew up saying aunt, and then I moved to a place where everyone said aunt. So anybody whose name that I learned after I moved to that state, I would call aunt instead of aunt. But, like, my aunts that I grew up with, I would still call them aunt. Aunt. In St. Louis, you is now powerless needs to be a grammar meme. Like, yeah, and that's actually part of his character, St. John. That's the whole thing with the wizard. He has poor grammar. That's deliberate. Okay, yep, so everything's the same here. Good King Studies, room 1. Remember that number? That's where we're at least going to be able to fill up our hourglass at some point. All right. Thank you so much for the honey. Now we can have our tea. And here are the morals. Before you run away, be still and listen. So she's giving us the morals. That villain Oxon hid the fables throughout the palace, so you will have to go to the palace to find them. Once the fables and the morals are matched together and the Book of Fables is complete, the magic will return. You will be saved and the fair king will rule again. Here are the morals, now be on your way. So before we go to the palace, now that we have a ton of time for the moment, I just want to see what's down here. Because I think we met everybody. I don't think there are any other animals, right? I think we've met them all. Well, you wanted to name the planets, and now we've named them all. And then after they finished singing the song, the sun would say, "One more time." And then they sang it twice, and then after they finished singing it the second time, the sun said, "One more time." And Steve was like, "No, I think we got it, Mr. Sun. Thank you." I thought that was really funny. Well, hello, Mr. Sun. True story, I downloaded that Blue's Clues tune on Napster back in the day. So I have it on my computer somewhere. I don't even know how I got that off of Napster. What did I even search for? Blue's Clues Planets? And somebody actually clipped that? Me and the only other person in the world who wanted to actually play that in their CD player walking around town. You hear it both ways in Des Moines, but aunt seems more common than aunt. It's funny because I grew up in New Jersey and we put yous in words where there aren't yous, so you would expect us to say aunt. All right, the dog says, "Before you enter the palace to find the fables, listen carefully to me." Oxon turned the king's courtiers into statues. 8 rooms have statues in them. The statues know where the fables are hidden. They can talk and they will help you find the fables. When you enter a room with a statue, it will tell you whether or not there is a fable in that room. If there is a fable, then search the room to find it. If there isn't a fable, go into a different room. Except for room 4. Thank you, Simon. But watch out, Oxon will sometimes disguise himself as a statue, and he will lie. Always do the opposite of what he suggests. You'll know that it's Oxon speaking because he uses bad grammar. For example, he'll say, "Why doesn't you look under the chair for a fable?" See, he said doesn't when he should have said don't. Grammar pup. Since he always lies, it would be a waste of time to look under the chair. He wants you to use up your time. Then you will be his prisoner forever. When you find a fable, you will get to read it. Then you will have to match it with the correct moral. There are 4 fables to be found. Good luck. This game made me obsessed with Aesop's Fables. I had a huge Aesop's Fable book, a really, really thick one. So room 1 is the wizard's study, not the wizard's study, the king's study, where we can refill our hourglass, and we want to avoid room 4. Now here's the problem. As a kid, I would always mess up what room numbers were up and down, so you folks are going to have to help me out. We are currently in room 9. So I'm going to guess to the right is room 8. Going to be in descending order. No, it's in 10. Watch your time and don't look near the fireplace. All right, that's grammatically correct. So we went 9, 10. I really should write this down because now I'm paranoid that I'm gonna... Let me see if I can grab a piece of paper here. Just real quick. 9, 10, 11.
Accidentally turning into the wizard's study was terrifying. 12.
So 9, 10, 11, 12, so...
Let's do... This should be an odd number up and down, I think. I think these will always be odd, right?
9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16.
Okay, so let us check out what number this is. How does someone with such bad grammar become a wizard? That's a good question, Simon.
Room 7. This is 7. So that's going to be 8. 6, 5.
I know a fable are behind the shield, so we're not going to waste our time with that.
So this is going to be probably 1, 2, 3, 4. Like this. This is my guess. I'm just quickly writing it down. So 7 will go off to the right.
But then we're not going to go up, because up will be room 4. But we're going to head towards room 1 instead. Move the curtain and you'll find a fable. Okay, room 8. Search. You found a fable. I knew there was one here. The Ant and the Grasshopper. All summer long, the grasshopper sang and played while his neighbor, the ant, worked hard storing food for the winter. Summer is a time for fun, said the grasshopper. P for next page. So here's where we have to match the fable to the moral. So we have all the morals. We have to find all 4 fables. So here's our first. That winter was very cold, and the grasshopper, with no food stored up, was hungry. Crawling to the ant's nest, the grasshopper begged for food, but the ant refused him, saying, "You sang all summer, grasshopper. Now dance all winter." That's cold. Okay, so that's the moral. Moral A is, if people know you are a liar, they will never believe you, even if you tell the truth. That's not right. Sometimes the weak may help the strong. That's not right. Prepare for the days ahead. Or a fool may disguise himself, but his words will give him away. Oop. I can't use the left arrow, apparently. I can always use the right. Only use the right. So I think prepare for the days ahead is a match. Moral chosen. So I think that's it. I think we've matched it together. See! Good job, Simon. You've seen a... I have never seen A Bug's Life. Now, oh, I didn't read that. I think it's just said, now go into the other rooms and something, something. I actually... are you going to tell me what you just told me? I don't like that I didn't read what you said. I'm sorry. I walked out in the middle of your sentence. You already found the fable in this room. You're running out of time. Quick, go look in another room. Okay, off I go. I know a fabler behind the shield. I don't trust you. So we're going to go up. This should be room 3. Room 3. There is no fable on the table. Okay. So we're not going to go to the right because that's the deadly room. I'm going to draw a little skull. And let's make our way leftwards because that's going to bring us to the king's study and we'll get more time. A fable ain't been placed upon the bookcase. I think we're going to search here. Ha! Don't be too confident. So you found a fable this time. Still, your time are running out. Ha! Isn't this kind of fun? This game is good. The Lion and the Mouse. A mouse once accidentally ran over a sleeping lion. The lion awoke and, holding the mouse under its paw, said, "Life's not fair, is it? You see, I will never be king. I'm going to eat you now because you woke me." P for next page. Bye, the Renaissance. Have a good time. We might be dropping in later. The mouse begged for mercy. "Let me go, lion, and I promise one day I will help you." "Help me?" the lion laughed. How could a little animal like you ever help a strong animal like myself? He let the mouse go, still laughing. Simon, I think you might be on to something. A few weeks later, the lion was captured by hunters and tied to a tree. The mouse heard the lion's frightened groans and came to its aid. With its sharp little teeth, the mouse chewed through the ropes and set the lion free. There, Mr. Lion, the mouse said. I told you I would help you one day. Thank you, Simon. Scar is one of the great villains. Sometimes the weak may help the strong. Let's match it. And you shall never see the light of another day. Adieu. Ha, now I suppose as you is going to run off to another room to look for more fables. I think you is getting too confident. You wills be my prisoner soon, ha? I is not must leave now, KeyGlyph. It is not timing to work on the show. I don't know if that was auto-correct or if that was on purpose, but I loved it. That was masterful. Masterful Oxon. Because of all the good magic in the study, your hourglass is now refilled with grains of sand. Excellent. So we've got time. Now we've already been through the second row of rooms, because we cut our way across. So we're just going to keep on going down, and we should be into room 9. Have a good night, St. John. Nerd noise. Good luck with all the work you have to get done. Room 9. So, wait a minute. There's a room to the left? What? That's odd. Because that's not the way we came in, is it? Or is it? Is this the way we came in? It is. Oh, that was the entrance. That was the entrance. Okay. So, wait a minute. Did I miss a row? Uh-oh. You're right. So, I thought did I weave through both rows? I thought I did, and I got the one in 8. Unless I didn't go all the way 5, 6, 7. I think I did all those. I know we haven't gone down. So we'll go ahead and do that. Though we might have to cross around that room up there. We need to see room 14. Thanks for being on top of it, Simon. A fable was never hid near the stool. You should have said, hidden, Oxon. Ha, don't be too confident. So you found a fable this time. Still, your time are running out, ha. The Boy Who Cried Wolf. One of the most classic of all. A shepherd boy played a joke on the villagers. Wolf, he shouted, even though there was no wolf. All the villagers came running to help him save his sheep, but when they arrived, they found him laughing. It's not funny to lie, said a villager, annoyed at the boy. But the boy thought it was funny, and the next day he cried, Wolf! Once again. The villagers once again answered his cry, and again they found him laughing. A few days later, a pack of wolves really did attack his sheep. Wolf! Cried the boy. Help! Wolf! It's just that joker again, the villager said. So nobody came to help the boy, and the wolves ate his sheep. Sad story. Okay, moral of the story is, if people know you as a liar, they will never believe you, or sometimes the weak... No, we already matched that one. Matched that one. So, I hope they've been matched, even though... Moral chosen. It concerns me that it didn't only show me the options I still have left. Because if I hit return again, it's not chosen. So I think that locks it in. So I hit escape. So this was... 13... 14, 15, 16, most likely. I made that mistake so many times as a kid, going into the wrong room and counting it wrong, that I'm really paranoid. Even though I'm writing it all down right now, and I'm looking at it, and it makes sense, I just feel like I'm gonna mess it up.
Ha! Now I suppose as you was going to run off to another room to look for more fables. I think you's getting too confident. You will be my prisoner soon, ha?
Will there ever be two fables with the same moral? I don't think so. I don't think it would work that way. I think it's a one-for-one kind of deal.
Look behind that painting if you seeking a fable.
No thanks, fake lady.
I knows whose use is.
So hopefully our last fable is in here.
There is a fable behind that chair.
Search.
You found a fable. I knew there was one here.
The donkey in the lion's skin. A silly donkey dressed in a lion's skin ran through the forest, scaring all the animals. Watch the hourglass during this and tell me if time passes while we're actually doing these morals. Because I kind of wonder. That seems unfair, and our hourglass has definitely not been running down as quickly as it did before. When he came up to the fox, he tried to roar, but all that came out was, "Eeyaw, eeyaw."
"Silly donkey," the fox said. The gnarled fox said, "If you want to scare me, you will have to sound like a lion, not just look like one."
Okay, so we know what this is.
A fool may disguise himself, but his words will give him away.
All right. We've matched them all.
If you walk the walk, you have to talk the talk. You found all the fables. Now hurry and bring the book back to the king. Off we go.
I once was in such a hurry to get out of the palace that I ran into the wizard's study on the way out. That was brutal.
But this is a short enough game that you play it again and you feel satisfied. It's fun, and it's kind of,
I found it suspenseful as all of the rooms load, waiting to see what's going to happen.
You found all the fables. Now hurry and bring the book back to the king. I'm on my way. I'm on my way, Gimli.
I didn't notice any sand dropping during the reading.
Yeah, so I think because that would be punishing kids. Because this is supposed to be educational, so I would think that if the hourglass ran down while you were reading the fables, that would be unfair.
You found the fables! Now hurry to the Frog King!
That would be a poor design choice for a game that's trying to teach kids stuff, you know?
You'd love to see it with a better frame rate, but you're right about the suspense.
Yeah, can you hear me clicking as I walk?
One stroke of the key is like one step. But it doesn't log. If I like mash the key 5 times, it doesn't put those 5 keystrokes into memory for me. So I do just kind of continually tap, 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 tap. And again, like we read in the manual, there are 4 different versions of this game, basically 4 different layouts of the animals and 4 different combinations of fables and morals and things, so it's fun. There's replay value built into it. And it does get really stressful in that first leg. Before you get into the palace and refill your hourglass, as you saw earlier, I failed. So it does get a little bit... I do remember it being very suspenseful in the beginning, like, am I going to be able to get to the king's study? Will I be able to refill my hourglass?
Yeah, radioactive man, click, 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 click. You've done it! You put the Book of Fables back together correctly. I can feel myself turning back into a human.
Simon says, I miss games with replay value. It's not as common as it used to be.
Yeah, I think... I don't know if I would quite put it that way, but I do think that games are focusing more now on, like, very long, drawn-out experiences with content that you can still work on, but not replayability in the sense of, I've done it. Let's do it again. Let's go through the same kind of linear thing again and again.
Wow, there he is! I like your pink robes, King. Looking good in fuchsia.
Magenta.
Simon says, don't give him the book! Keep it! Take the throne for yourself! Simon, were you also the one that suggested that I kick Akuma again while he was dead on the ground? I can't remember if that was you or not. It might not have been, but if it is, I think that's funny. You got a theme going. A Machiavellian theme. How can I ever thank you? I think Simon has an idea. Simon says, you can thank me by giving me the throne. Before you leave Fabulon, let me tell you one more fable. It's my favorite. It's called The Wind and the Sun. Before I read this, I have to tell you something about taking the throne for yourself. Simon, were you watching Hungry stream? I can't remember what it was called. She was streaming an RPG on the Game Boy. Were you there for that at the end? The heck was it called? I can't remember. Popo says, is this where SMB3 got the idea of turning a transformed king back into humans? I mean, maybe. Yeah, Great Greed. So, Simon, can I spoil it for you? Or do you not want spoilers? Because if you don't want spoilers, I'll hold back. But it's relevant to what we're talking about. Thanks, Musty and Simon. Okay, so at the end of Great Greed, the king is basically like, congratulations, you've saved the kingdom, and you can choose one of my daughters to marry. And so we were all kind of like, well, that's sort of gross, king. He does say that they've all expressed an interest in being your bride, but it's just weird for a dad to be like, choose one of my girls. But you're in a room with the different princesses and other characters, and you can choose, it turns out, any character in that room to marry. The king will kind of give you grief if you don't choose one of his daughters, but then they'll let you go through it. So what Hungry did the first time she played, this was amazing. She walked up to the queen and talked to the queen. And the king was like, no, can you choose one of my daughters? And she was like, no, I'm gonna talk to the queen again. So she talks to the queen again, and the king says, I see. You really like that person that much? And she said, yes. And the king was like, I understand, and I hope you have a great life together. She, the most amazing royal power play ever. So she wound up marrying the queen, and then these like little dancers come in to celebrate the impending marriage. It was so funny. It was so funny. And then she, you could marry the king if you wanted to. So she married the king. The king was not happy about that, but he was like, fine. I don't get you, but fine. But there was another character in the room that she married. And I didn't watch enough of the gameplay to know who it was, but it was some, you know, sort of like minor male character. And when she married him, you get like a little bit of extra dialogue with the person that you marry. And some of it was weird. Like the king said, I don't know what your tastes are, which was such a weird thing to say. And some of the other daughters said, like, there was a really kind of kick-butt warrior, and when you talked to her, her line was, I'll try my best to be a more attractive woman. And we were like, ew, gross! You're great the way you are, game. Why are you putting that on us? But when you talked to this male minor character in that extra dialogue part, he said, like, are you sure you want to spend all your time with me? Well, I will do my best to love you with all my heart. And we were just like, oh my god, that's so sweet. Who knew that that random NPC would be the one that would have the most pure and lovely dialogue as your new spouse? That was wonderful. But it was so funny when she chose the queen and the king was like, fine, bring in the celebratory dancers. And these women characters come in and they're spinning and it's got happy music playing. It was so funny. I took a clip of that and I titled it one wedding and a divorce or something like that. It's funny. Musty said minor or had a minor role. Had a minor role, small role. I don't think that they were a major character is what I'm trying to say. But that was just really funny. Okay, let's go back to Fabulon for a second. We're going to hear the tale of the wind and the sun. The wind and the sun were always arguing about who was stronger. One day, a villager heard them arguing. The villager looked up and said, "Why don't you have a contest to see who is stronger? The one who can take my cloak from me will be the winner." I remember this one. "That's easy," said the wind, and she huffed and puffed with a great roar and tried to blow the villager's cloak off, but the man just held on to his cloak more tightly. "That's the wrong approach," said the sun. "Watch me." And as he shone more brightly, the man grew warmer and warmer. Finally, with sweat starting to appear on his forehead, the man took his cloak off just to cool himself down. The son was like, "No, no, 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 you have to try to kill the guy. You must put him in a lethal situation, and then he will remove his cloak." The moral is, put people in lethal situations when you want to get what you want. No, the moral is, you will be more successful with persuasion than with force. The wind tried to use force to get the cloak off, but the man resisted. The son, on the other hand, used gentle, manipulative persuasion. And he was successful. You see, the wind is like Oxon. He wanted to rule Fabulon, and he tried to force the people to do his bidding, but they preferred my fair rule to his forceful ways. Only with his magic could he take over, and now that you have recovered the book, he is helpless, and we are all safe. You say goodbye to the king. Oh yeah, our tree's gonna get cut down. I wonder what happens in our frame tale. You say goodbye to the king, because I've forgotten that part, and walk out of the forest. Your neighbor is just entering his yard carrying a power saw. "I'm ready to clear some space for my garden," he says. What a jerk. Ooh, decision point. What do you want to say? If you cut even one tree down, I'll pull up all your plants when they grow. If you plant your garden somewhere else and leave the trees alone, I'll help you with your garden. Or if you cut the trees down, I'll get the evil wizard Oxon to turn you into a donkey. Alright, so look. Obviously the game wants us to pick the persuasive option, because we just got that whole tale about this. 3-3-3. But our neighbor stinks. I question that we are trying to cooperate and come to a consensus with someone who is probably cutting down trees that aren't on their property. So I don't particularly feel like being compromising with this person. 3 is quite persuasive. Popo says, if you strike the tree down, it shall become more powerful than you can possibly imagine. I really want to pick one of the incorrect options. And 3 is clearly the coolest. Simon's on to it. So I think we're going to go ahead and go with 3. But if we choose 2, we get to keep our treehouse, obviously, is where this is going. But let's do it. We've learned nothing! Your neighbor calls your parents and says you are annoying him. Your parents punish you by making you clean up the basement. As you walk down the basement stairs, you hear the growl of the power saw motor. The end. That is so sad. That line, as you walk down the basement stairs, you hear the growl of the power saw motor. That is so sad. When I was a kid, it's sort of hard to explain how my house was situated, because it was not facing the street. So if this was the street, my house was facing like that way. And there was a little driveway that ran between our house and this other house right across from us that faced us. And that driveway was eventually, it was planned to cut through to the street down that way, but it never did. They never finished it for whatever reason. I'm not really sure. So it just was our driveway. So my backyard, which was really my side yard based on how my, it would have been my backyard if my house were facing the street. My backyard kind of shared space with other houses that were on the street that would have been connected. I'm not explaining this well, but our driveway came and stopped. And then coming from the other direction, there was a private driveway that came down a little bit and stopped. And then there was just land in between. So my basement shared space with those houses that were along that, my backyard, shared space with other houses on that other private street. And we had a neighbor back there whom I loved. I actually mentioned her on an Apple II stream before. There was an older woman who lived back there alone, and I would leave print shop cards on her doorstep with like little flowers that I picked and stuff. I really loved her. She moved out eventually when I was older, when I was in middle school, I think, and some other guy moved in, and this guy was a landscaper, and I might have told this story on stream before, so I apologize, but he was a landscaper, and his version of landscaping was basically cut down anything that he didn't plant himself. He's one of those folks that had, like, a radioactive green lawn, and it was just grass. You know, there's nothing else on it. And on that property, there was this beautiful cherry blossom tree, and that was one of the first things that he cut down. And I was so sad about it. I actually asked him while he was cutting the tree down, can I have a slice of the trunk? And he was like, okay. And he gave it to me. And he talked to my parents later, just in passing, and was like, he was like dumbfounded that I would ask for a piece of the stump. He didn't understand how I could be sentimentally attached to the tree. And to flash back to the woman who used to live there, she was kind enough to my family to say that my brother and I could play on her property whenever we wanted. We could play on any of the property whenever we wanted. And I loved that tree, so I would play, you know, around that tree. So that was really sad. But also, so his house, that used to be her house, was across this private drive in the back. And the private drive abutted our backyard. And we had some mulberry trees along our fence. So right on the edge of our property, essentially, right against that private drive, we had these mulberry trees. And if you've ever seen a mulberry tree, they drop a ton of stuff in the summer. They drop a lot of mulberries. Our backyard would become slick with them, you know, as you squished them. And they would drop on that private drive, and they would drop on his lawn. And the previous owner, the woman that I loved, had no problem with that. He hated it, as you might imagine, because this was his pristine lawn. So one day, now the trees were on our side of that street, that private drive, so they weren't on his property, they were on our side, and they were leaning up against our fence. They were, like, almost merged with our fence. Hey, Brigand, what's up? Mulberries are not filberts, it's true. So imagine this. One day, I'm home after school, and I hear a saw start up, and I'm thinking, what is he cutting down now? And I look out my brother's bedroom window, because that was facing the backyard, and I see him starting to cut branches off of our mulberry trees. Trees that were not even on his side of the private drive, and were clearly merging with our fence, he was cutting the branches down. And I panicked, because I was sort of scared of this guy at this point. And my brother happened to come home while this was happening, and I ran outside, and I said, Eric, he's cutting down our trees! Can you please stop him from cutting down our trees? So Eric's in high school. Eric runs into the backyard. He just, like, goes. He doesn't even say, like, Emily, what's the deal? He just goes. And I don't know what he said, you know, he just was like, what are you doing? These are our trees, probably. I was watching scared from his window. And we stopped the guy from cutting down the trees. Now his, Simon says, this sounds like small claims court waiting to happen. Yeah, so he stopped because he knew we were home and we were watching. But, you know, we told our parents. So our parents went over to have a chat with him. And his line was that he thought that the trees were on his property. He thought that his property line extended past that private driveway that wasn't his, it was a driveway that was shared by multiple houses. He not only thought that trees that weren't on his side of the street were his to cut down, but ones that were clearly almost in our backyard, he thought that his property line somehow extended up to our backyard property line. And I think my parents maybe were sort of buying it, but I was like, there's no way that a landscaper doesn't understand how property lines work. Or doesn't know how to look up how property lines work. I was convinced that the guy was just going to cut down our trees while we weren't home, and then when we came home, say, oh, sorry, I didn't realize that they were yours. They're dead now. Can I plant something that I like? And this was actually, in my mind, confirmed later by the fact that after he abandoned cutting down our trees, he later approached my parents and said, hey, I'll strike you a deal. If you let me cut down your mulberry trees, I will plant new trees for you for free, of whatever you want, as long as it's not a mulberry tree. So I saw through to the heart of that guy. And my parents almost went along with it because I think they were also annoyed by the mulberry trees, but I cried. And I was, like, kind of getting at, like, this is a thing of principle now and ethics, that we cannot let this guy cut down our trees. We can't give him what he wants. And so those mulberry trees stayed there for the rest of our tenure at that house. But as you can see, how long did that story take? Like 10 minutes? I've got some personal baggage that I'm bringing to this game. So yeah, I'm gonna get Oxon to turn that guy into a donkey. Isn't that bananas, though? Can you imagine somebody just trying to cut down trees that are clearly not on his property while he thinks you're not home? Because there were no cars in our driveway. I think he really tried to plan it and didn't anticipate that I was home from school. So, but we didn't like challenge him in court or anything. But he also cut down a whole bunch of forsythia bushes that my dad had planted and loved, that he also thought was on his property, even though it clearly wasn't. This broke my dad's heart, but the forsythia bushes came back. They could not be killed, so they grew back. And so we were like, haha, yeah, deal with it. The forsythia bushes grew back. But what a jerk. Kitsarito says, sounds like this guy just hates nature, right? A landscaper, you know? Strange business for somebody to be into who just wants to rip up and destroy everything. So anyway. Oh, another decision. What do we want to do? Oh, start over with the same fable, start over with new fables, or quit. So let's go ahead and quit. With that very traumatizing ending based on my childhood experience. Radioactive Man from Mars says, I don't know if it's different from state to state, but here you can only cut down the part of trees that are overhanging into your yard. Yeah, so, right? And we had an issue with another neighbor. The neighbor on our other side, we had a limb fall from one of our trees into their backyard, like a big limb. So it wasn't just a piddly thing. And after the limb fell, we found out that squirrels had basically hollowed out the whole tree, so it was dangerous and could continue shedding pieces into their yard. But we negotiated with them on that, and we did actually wind up cutting down the whole tree when we found out that the whole tree was a problem. But yeah, one of the options on the table was just to trim the tree back. Exactly what you're saying. Simon says, what was part two of the plan? Gee, I didn't see anything. No, it wasn't me. What saw? Where? Yeah. So why don't we spend a little bit of time? We have a little bit of time left. Let's just take a look at other stuff that's on this disc. We are going to come back to The Secret of the Sphinx someday. And when we do, we're going to look at the first ever video game guide that I typed up myself. For some reason, I actually wrote out the steps on how to beat this game, and I wrote three different versions of how to beat it. Like, here's the way to do all the steps, here's the shortcut, and here's, like, little hints to get you through in case you don't want things spoiled. So that's fun, but we're gonna leave that. Space! Says Popo. Radioactive Man from Mars says, then there's just common courtesy. Yeah, right? We're gonna check out who's who in outer space, because clearly the audience is interested in this. So we're not going to do Secret of the Sphinx, and we will maybe read the other things, but we'll definitely check out who's who in outer space. Brigand says, my grandparents had two pecan trees, not pecan. I say, oh, so maybe I am saying it your way, pecan? But I think I used to say pecans, but I would say pecan pie. You had pecan trees, that's actually awesome. Your grandparents, and they shed hundreds of pecans every summer. I got so sick of pecans. That's funny. You say the same pecan. Kapla. Who's who in outer space? That program is on the other side. Turn the disc over and press return. Pecan pie. That's how Janeway says it in Voyager. Pecan pie. In her Kate Mulgrewy way. Pecan is for Sandies. Pecan is for everything else. Oh, pecan Sandies. Yeah. Are those the shortbread cookies? Am I thinking of the right thing? Is pecan? Pecan? That's blasphemy. Strong feelings about pecans in the chat right now. The proper way to pronounce. I mean, I'm for everybody saying it the way they want to say it.
Who's who in outer space? Let me look at the manual on this for a sec. That's cool. That space station. Let's see what the manual says about who's who in outer space. The Secret of the Sphinx and the Frog and the Fables must have taken up a ton of space on this disc because there's not a whole lot of mini game stuff. Ooh! I wrote notes in here. I can't go here if stuck. I drew in this manual. And I also wrote, blank is the answer. That's not my handwriting. That's my mom's handwriting. So I must have had her write that down for me. Who's who in outer space? Brigham says, I'm surprised how many games you have for the Apple II. I have a lot. I mean, they all came with the computer. I never bought any more. That's not true. I bought maybe one or two Microzines as an adult, but it just came with a ton of cracked games from the person who owned it before us. And I'm definitely thinking about buying more because I love doing these Apple IIsday streams. And I'm missing some of the classics, and people are suggesting to me, oh, play this one, play that one. So I may actually, you know, use some of my Ko-fi funds to buy more and things like that, because it's really fun. And we're also doing preservation work here, you know, and I think that that's really important. Okay, who's who in outer space? Here is a database that explores strange new worlds, seeks out new life, new civilizations. This sounds familiar now. A database that boldly stores what no database has stored before. Yes. Seeks out new life, new civilizations. A database that boldly stores what no data has stored before. What you'll find. Who's who in outer space? Should I sing the song too? Ba-da-da-da-da-da-da. Who's Who in Outer Space is a database of 200 real and imaginary personalities. You can look through the entire database or find lists of personalities by choosing categories to search under. Okay, find, choose this function to search through the database for specific personalities. Okay, fields, there are 7 fields you can search under. They are profession, real sci-fi, classification, space travel, accomplishments, planet, and NASA programs. So we'll get into that. I think it might actually be kind of fun to try to just straight up search for things that we think might be in the database and see if they're in there. Like, you know, Mr. Spock or something, and see if there's actually an entry. That would be kind of fun. Categories. There are up to 10 categories under each field. For example, the categories under profession are astronaut, Russian cosmonaut, pilot, starship crew, astronomer, scientist, explorer, hero, villain, and other. The computer will search through the database to find the personalities in the category, and then it will display the number of personalities that were found. The computer will ask, would you like to see a list of the personalities? YN. By the way, I love to say that in actual everyday conversation. If I ask somebody a question like, Nathaniel, do you feel like going out to eat at this restaurant? YN. Type N for no if you want to add another field to your search. Type Y for yes to see the list of personalities. Press return to see each of the entries. Type Y for yes to see the list again. Blah, blah. How to search for personalities. You can search through the database using from 1 to 7 fields. Each time the computer finishes a search under one field, you can add another category under a different field. You can only search under one category per field. For example, choose the field profession and the category astronaut. The program will search for all astronauts in the database. Then choose the field accomplishments. Okay, so I don't think we can just type in a name. I think we can't just type in a search. I think we have to go through their schema. If you choose a category in which there are no entries, the computer will display this message. Category empty, choose another. For example, if you choose profession astronaut and then choose classification alien plant, the computer will display the category empty message. Okay. Okay. Let's check it out. Thank you for my good use of schema. I am a librarian, so this is what I think in all the time. So let's find. Do you folks want to do the choosing for me? Find. Do we want to search by profession? Real, sci-fi, classification, space travel, accomplishments, planet, or NASA programs. Folks, just call out whatever you want, and we'll just sort of go from there.
First one who types it in gets it. And if this isn't interesting, then I will just choose myself. I'm interested that they've lumped real sci-fi together. I don't... Why would you put fiction and... My category is fiction and nonfiction. Well, what's not in your category, then? Space travel. Okay. What method of travel should we use? Rocket, starship, flying saucer / UFO, meteor, animals, time travel, or other? This is getting intriguing. Intriguing, Captain. Meteor. There's nothing in there. Oh, wait. Oh, look, it's searching through all the items. Ooh, this is cool. Neat. Do you have a thought of who it's gonna be? Space travel by a meteor? Three personalities found. But I'd like to see a list of these personalities. Genova. Name, the blob. Really? The blob was from a meteor? I didn't know that. Science fiction personality profile. In 1958, this gooey, man-eating monster came from outer space inside a meteor. It was finally destroyed by a quick-thinking teenager. Other data, this alien appeared in the movie The Blob. That's so cool. I've never seen The Blob. I like that its profile isn't suggesting that it's not real, and then other data is sort of like, I don't know, it's funny. This alien appeared in the movie The Blob. All right, well, what's next? Maybe the pod people came from a meteor? I'm not really sure. Martians! In 1898, these bug-eyed aliens from Mars invaded Earth hidden inside meteors and tried to conquer the planet with their death rays. Read The War of the Worlds by H.G. Wells or see the 1953 movie of the same name. I have an issue with this. Those weren't... Well, maybe I don't have an issue with that. They came to Earth and then built their tripods in the crater that the meteor made. But I wouldn't say that they came on a meteor, because I don't... Well, if a meteor is just a piece of stuff, does it have to be a certain kind of rock? Because if it's just an object that comes through space to us and then becomes a meteorite, okay. But I always thought of them traveling in... a Martian-made device that looked like a meteor, and then they added attachments to it and built their tripods. Yeah, and in the original movie, because I've read the book, I have not seen the original movie, but in the book, it's not like explicit that they were riding rocks, but I. Popo, I like your... The important thing is that it was a non-braked crash landing. Yes, that's actually what we're going for here. That's really funny. A non-braked crash landing. That's funny. Musty says, the War of the Worlds remake was like lightning strikes. Yeah, Okay, look. War of the Worlds is one of my favorite books, and I was really excited for the remake. But it didn't make any sense, and they removed the best parts of the book, in my opinion. I don't know how many of you plan to read the book, but I can tell you the parts that are awesome about the book that movie left out. I haven't seen the original movie, so I can't speak to that, but they removed some of the most important moments. IMHO. Brigand says, the 1953 movie scared you as a kid. Simon says the 50s blob was from a meteor. The 80s remake was a bioweapon that escaped. There was a remake of the blob? Wow, I didn't even know. I want to write a modern one that's essentially gray goo nanites from a programmable mattress that was hooked up to the internet and went berserk. Do it! Popa says the book had such a weird cadence to the writing. Spec says, please tell, I haven't read it yet. So, Simon, I'm not. I know of The League of Extraordinary Gentlemen in passing, but I haven't seen the movie. And that's the one that, like, combined two characters from Dracula, right? No. The hero from Dracula, Helsing, right, was in the League of Extraordinary... Dorian Gray? They pulled a whole bunch of random, like, literary figures, right? Something like that? So War of the Worlds, I mean, I'm not going to tell the whole story, but one of the defining moments that I have not seen happen in any kind of adaptation of the book. So, real quick. Martians on Mars, their planet's dying. They look at Earth with jealous eyes, and they want to take over because they need to survive. So, they come here. They don't really have bodies that do well in our gravity, so they build these tripod machines that they roam the countryside in. The book is fantastic. The way the book describes stuff is so frightening that at one point the main character is watching a hillside and they see the giant tripod in a lightning flash, and then in the next lightning flash they see it and it's moved like an impossible distance because it's just moving so fast. So they build these tripod machines, and one of the best moments in the book for me is the human forces are trying to destroy the tripods and we're not having a whole lot of success. But there's a scene where we actually take one down. There are three tripod machines attacking this particular area, and they're using their heat beam, their laser beam. And as they use the laser beam, humans are, like, taking refuge in a river nearby, but when the beam hits the water, it, like, boils the water. It's, like, it's so frightening and scary and causes... But we manage to take one of those three tripods down, and the other two... I've never seen a War of the Worlds adaptation where we actually took down a tripod, and that, I feel, is a mistake, because when we actually take down one in the book, you feel like it's possible. It's so hard, but it's possible. They're not invincible. Maybe we can do this. We take one of them out, and the other two are mid-attack, and they stop. The tripods make their way to the fallen tripod. They pick it up and they carry it away. And it's such a cool moment, because in that moment you realize they care about their fallen comrade. They're not just faceless supervillains, you know. They're doing this horrible thing, but they gave up their attack because it was more important to take care of their fallen comrade. Really good. Also, if you read the book, H.G. Wells is constantly making comparisons to what the Martians are doing to us, to what we do to animals. So it is commentary. It'll be like, he'll make the comparison to a rabbit warren that's been suddenly dug up to build a house, and the main character will describe that, like, that must be what this feels like, to have his hometown decimated by these things that want to build their own civilization that he's, you know... and they talk about what we did to indigenous peoples, too, that we just sort of steamrolled indigenous peoples. It's really good. It's really, really good. So I loved that moment. And the other moment that is so good in War of the Worlds is we've taken down, in the book, we took down one of the tripod machines, and then, like, all of Earth's military, well, not all of Earth's military, probably just, it took place in Europe, by the way, in the book, but a huge coordinated attack of artillery sets up to try to take out the tripod machines, because now we know we can do it with torpedoes. So, like, all of Earth's or all of Europe's forces concentrate themselves in one basic like semicircle to intercept the coming tripod machines and shoot them down. And the tripod machines come to a certain point and they stop where they're out of range of torpedoes, and they let out a gas. And the vantage point, you're seeing this scene from the vantage point of the main character, so the main character doesn't know what's going on. They're just watching the scene. So they see all of the artillery, they see the tripod machines, and they see this gas. And then there's a pause, and then the tripod machines continue walking forward, and the main character, you know, the narrator of the story, is like, why isn't the army firing? Why is nothing happening? They've crossed into the target area. And so, of course, you find out that the Martians have released a gas that has killed all of the humans that were waiting to shoot the torpedoes. And when you read that, I remember feeling so crushed, because not only was that maneuver a failure, but humans had pooled all of their resources into that one attack and they put themselves all in one spot, put all of their eggs in one basket, and they all got wiped out. And when you read that part of the book, you just feel like, that's the end. There's no coming back from this. We've lost. And it's like in the middle of the book, or three quarters of the way through, and I really felt the impact of that. And the other thing, I'm just going to ruin the whole book for you. I'm sorry that I'm going off on a book tangent, but I love War of the Worlds. At the end, we all know the ending of War of the Worlds, right? What actually does the Martians in. Simon says, BRB, going to Amazon. Musty says, that's where you hope you had a save point. Yes, exactly. That's where you're like, whoops, restart. Spec says, ouch, yeah, that whole story, even the movie versions, was always so harrowing to me. I need to read it, but I'm also scared to read it now. So we know that the Martians are done in by, they need to harvest our blood, and they are not, they don't have, like, the antibodies to deal with the things that are hanging out in our blood that we are fine with, so they basically are killed by the humble germ. But, and that's what everybody talks about at the end of the book. Like, isn't that so cool that they're done in by the germ? All of our effort was for naught, but it's just the germ. But what I thought was really amazing at the end of the book is the main character describes... We know at the end of the book that the Martians are failing for some reason, I think, but we don't know why. The main character, by the way, is just kind of like a... Popo says, the most humble of God's creatures, the Tyrannosaurus Rex, yes. So the main character is sort of like a non-personality. It's one of those sort of classic old-timey protagonists through which you are just living the beats of the story. They just are going through the motions, you know, so that you can see everything that you need to see. So it's plausible that you view these scenes. It's not like the main character is really doing anything. They're just witnessing the destruction. At the end of the book, the Martians are failing, and we don't know why, and the protagonist describes this sound that they start hearing, and I think they describe it as like an ooh-ah, ooh-ah siren in the distance, and they can't figure out what it is. And what it is the last Martian in the last tripod that has survived. So all the other Martians are dead, and it is the last Martian crying that they've lost, and that all of their friends have been lost. And the character describes it as this haunting, plaintive cry. And so you feel, the book makes you feel bad for the Martians because it equivocates us with them, and you understand that they're in a difficult situation, and that's why they feel that they have to do this to survive. And then also there are chapters that just outline how horrible human beings are. There's a whole chapter that's dedicated to a town that's trying to evacuate and all the terrible things that people do to each other because they're so afraid and trying to save themselves. People who like get run over by carts because people won't stop their carts because they're trying to evacuate. So it's good. I can't recommend it enough. That's the sound of a dying giraffe. Simon says, you don't need a translator to understand what the sound meant. It's so good, and it's so well written. I just love, H.G. Wells is one of my favorite authors, and I just love him. I loved Invisible Man, not The Invisible Man, which is a different book, but Invisible Man is a really good book, because H.G. Wells thinks of these things that are really interesting. Like, in Invisible Man, a scientist concocts a way to become invisible, and he thinks about this enough to realize that if you can't see your body walking downstairs, you're gonna have a lot of trouble walking downstairs. So the main character actually can't, because he can't see his feet, and he wants to be looking at his feet on the stairs, he has such trouble going down stairwells until he teaches himself to just look straight ahead and not think about it. Like, that's really thoughtful. That's very insightful. Time Machine is really good, but War of the Worlds is my favorite by far. That's an excellent book, so. All right. I have not read 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. Would you recommend it? So I'm sorry I just went on this really long rant. We still need to find out what the third... Look what this did! This one entry here. My goodness. My goodness. I'm sorry, but thank you for listening. I get so excited about books that I think are really great. I gotta go reread War of the Worlds now. And I bought a specific copy that had a specific... You know what? I'm going to go get it. Hang on. One second.
Okay. This is my copy of War of the Worlds. I had borrowed it from a library, and it had this particular cover. I'm very particular about the covers that I pick up. So I waited and waited and waited until I could find the particular cover, because I thought that this one had the coolest interpretation of what the tripod machines looked like. I just thought that that was super scary. Like, I think usually they look kind of like squid monsters with, you know, because they do have tentacles. But I just think that piece of art is so evocative. The fact that they're in the fog like that. You can see it a bit better on the back. But I thought that was such a really cool design. A really cool design. I just loved it so much.
I'll read you the back of the book. No one would have believed in the last years of the 19th century that this world was being watched keenly and closely by intelligences greater than man's and yet as mortal as his own. So begins the War of the Worlds, the science fiction classic that first proposed the possibility of intelligent life on other planets and has enthralled readers for almost 90 years. This has that good old book smell. Yeah, so I just... so good. I want to see if I can find that ooh-wah-ooh-wah thing. I'm so sorry. We're not playing games anymore. I'm so sorry, everybody. Let me see. Dum-dum-dum-dum-dum-dum. Oh, it's Allah, Allah, Allah. It's not ooh-wah, it's Allah. Okay. Let me see. Let me just read a little bit of this. Oh, look, I dog-eared the page. Yes, I'm a librarian who dog-ears pages, and I'm not afraid to admit it. Okay. In South Kensington, the streets were clear of dead and of black powder. It was near South Kensington that I first heard the howling. It crept almost imperceptibly upon my senses. It was a sobbing alternation of two notes, Allah, 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 keeping on perpetually. When I passed streets that ran northward, it grew in volume, and houses and buildings seemed to deaden and cut it off again. It came in a full tide down Exhibition Road. I stopped, staring towards Kensington Gardens, wondering at this strange, remote wailing. It was as if that mighty desert of houses had found a voice for its fear and solitude. Allah, 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 wailed the superhuman note. Great waves of sound sweeping down the broad, sunlit roadway between the tall buildings on each side. I turned northwards, marveling toward the iron gates of Hyde Park. Allah, I'm skipping some stuff. The desolating cry worked upon my mind. The mood that had sustained me passed. The wailing took possession of me. I found I was intensely weary, footsore, and now again hungry and thirsty. So let me find where he figures out what it is. Let's see. Well, here's part of it. As I crossed the bridge, the sound of Allah, 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 Allah ceased. It was, as it were, cut off. The silence came like a thunderclap. Bum, 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 bum. Yeah, so and then he climbs up the thing. He finds out that it's dead. Let me see. But yeah, I thought that just broke my heart. That one Martian crying, 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 crying. Such a good book. You has a sad. I do dog-ear pages. I unfold them when I'm done, but I dog-ear them because I write down important quotations in books that I love in a journal. Ever since I graduated college, I've been keeping a journal of all the books that I read, and I write down important passages, and I hate writing them down as I'm reading the book. So I do a little dog-ear, and it's fine. It doesn't hurt the integrity of the text. It's all still there. I have no problem with it. Simon, you recommend The Explorers, the 80s kid space adventure. There are significant clips of the War of the Worlds movie. That's interesting. Musty was terrified by the tri-colored eye. Yeah. Yeah. You are remembering it right. That's they snake the eye into the houses to see if they can find people in there. Robert Picardo was in The Explorers. Wow, that's interesting. The EMH. So anyway, let's find out what the third entry is, folks.
Thank you for listening to me ramble about books if you're still here. I love this book.
I love it.
Oh, The Island of Dr. Moreau. That's a really disturbing one. Also very good. Also very, very much commentary. Triffids. In 1963, a meteor shower blinded all of the humans who viewed it and brought seeds to Earth, which grew into man-eating weeds. These aliens appeared in the movie Day of the Triffids. What is this? Mr. Popo says, it's like a Reading Rainbow episode in chat today. I just made a Reading Rainbow episode, Reading Rainbow reference last night, so I'm like, this is my Reading Rainbow, da-da-da, you know. I read The War of the Worlds by H.G. Wells, and it was a fantastic book. Then you have the close-up of, like, the art. It's the story of Martians that came to Earth because their planet was dying and they needed a place to live. I highly recommend this book. I thought it was really great, and I hope you read it too. But don't take my word for it. Ba-dum-bum! Exactly, Popo. Exactly. Simon says, I hear there's a lot of sci-fi fans that don't know what a Triffid is. I don't know what a Triffid is. I've never heard of this movie, but I'm also movie dumb, so I'm not really surprised. You don't have to take my word for it. You heard someone compare the plant monsters in RE2 to Triffids. Really interesting. Those plants are a little silly in RE2. I feel like once we get down into that part of the game, it stops being quite as scary, and I feel a little bit silly. Dr. Moreau is one of your favorites. So good. I'm going to have to reread all of H.G. Wells' stuff. That book is really haunting. Triffids are actually quite silly looking. Oh, good. I'm on the right track. Okay. Let's not look at this list again. You want to do one more, and then we'll push everyone into another stream? Maybe one of you... Is somebody particularly interested in this? Because if somebody's really interested, if you want to go on a rant about something that you really love, because I just went on my War of the Worlds rant, then we can choose the options that may guide you towards it. So feel free. Feel free if you want to try to aim for a favorite movie or a favorite book or something like that. Because this is cool. I never used this part of the Microzine disc as a kid. I think I just didn't understand it, and I didn't have, I don't know, enough knowledge to get any of it, so. I'd be interested. This book is so good. I'm just gonna keep smelling it. I'm a book huffer. Don't laugh at my habits. My husband laughs at my book-sniffing ways. Simon says, I love biology, biodiversity, IDIC, genetic engineering, so I love that book. Heck, you're playing through sport right now. There you go. Biology is the best. You know what's sad? I took AP biology in high school, and I did well enough on the AP exam that I didn't need to take any more science in college. And that's a double-edged sword, because I was like, oh, really? I don't have to take any more science? I could have if I wanted to, but... Since I didn't have to, there were other English classes I could take, so I took those. But that was a bummer, to not take science in college. Why don't we... Let's see if, like, Simon says, oh! I mean, I'm not a genius at it, if that's what you're making the face for. I had a really great teacher. It's interesting that doing well enough in just biology got me out of, well, I mean, it got me out of, like, the required science courses, the science 101s. No science, I know. But luckily, science knowledge has stayed with me, so I haven't had to, my not taking classes hasn't made it all disappear, unlike my math knowledge, which erodes more with each passing day. Why don't we... Oh, Radioactive Man says, same here, I was also bummed after seeing the college classes available, but they wouldn't count. Oh, yeah. A lot of science folks in the chat. I wonder if there are people who are interested in space who aren't science people. You know what I mean? Like, I wonder if you can be interested in space in a way that's divorced from loving the actual, you know,
I don't want to say pursuit, but discipline of science. I'm sure it's like magic to somebody. Let's look at profession, actually, now that we're talking about. Biochemistry degree here. Nice, Musty. Holy smokes. Biochemistry, Musty, was the hardest thing I ever did in school. AP Biology was the one class that I legitimately struggled in because I was good at chemistry and I was good at biology, but there's something about biochemistry. There's something about having to remember the Krebs cycle. I just couldn't get my head around that kind of stuff. So I had to work so hard at it. And I was so proud of myself that I eventually kind of got it, but it just was so difficult for me. What profession do you want to find? Villain is a profession. What profession do we want to look into, folks? We are talking about scientists. Simon, you wish that you'd been advised to go into villainy? Should we click on that? Should we even call it clicking? Because we're not clicking. Should we select it? Radioactive Man laughs. Musty says, organic chem and physical chem and all that multivariable calculus were the toughest courses for me. Yeah, I didn't have to specialize in it, but we did a bit of it, you know. Let's go, says Simon. And it was just really hard. Balancing chemistry equations was easy for me, and I liked doing it, but remembering how many ATP get made in the Krebs cycle and why, and that half, some of it can loop, was just... Maybe I needed it to be given to me in a different way. I think that was an index. Oh, space travel, meteor, profession, villain. Oops, we didn't remove all of our searches, so I think we're going to get the same three. Let's just take a real quick look. And then we'll scrub this and we'll just do villain. Yeah, so the blob. Martians. And Triffids. Okay. No. So we need to... S to start over. Here we go. So let's start with profession. Villain. So now we've cleared our search terms. This is going to be our only search term. And then... Oh, they're just looking. All right. So we know what three of the villains are going to be. There are more. This will be fun. I hope we hit on some things that you folks love. Like, what if there's a Star Trek villain or a Star Wars villain that everyone gets really excited about that you see represented in this random database from the 1980s? What year was this? 1985. Popo says, today I learned that there is a thing called Jeff Wayne's musical version of The War of the Worlds, which is apparently quite popular. What? Details, please? All right. We'll go through these villains and then we'll push into somebody's stream and see what we've got here. Okay, so the blob, we know. The body snatchers. So this is what I was wondering, if they were from a meteor, but no. These seed pods invaded Earth by secretly duplicating people's bodies before taking over their identities. They appeared in the movie Invasion of the Body Snatchers. I have seen the original, and I enjoyed it. But I think the climactic moment is actually kind of funny, the way it happens. Cylons. Through a sneak attack, these half-human, half-robot aliens almost destroyed all human life in the galaxy. They appeared in the TV series Battlestar Galactica. Haven't we been talking about this, like, every stream? Where's Red? Red! We're talking about Battlestar... Isn't it Battlestar Galactica that she likes? No, wait. Is it? Or was it Babylon 5? Can't remember. Wow, this database has an entry from 2005. Was there a remake or something, Simon? Spec says, I can't remember if I ever saw that full movie or not, and now I'm curious what the climax was. The main character realizes that somebody that they care about has been switched, but they find out through a kiss, but there's narration during the scene. And so it says something like, I thought everything was fine, and then I kissed Peggy. And if you take that out of context, that's just really funny. Taking out the context of, and that's how he knew that she was a pod person, but I just thought that was really funny. Everything seemed fine. And then I kissed Peggy. It was the worst kiss. Daleks! Hey! Wow, that's cool. These citizens of the planet Skaro turned themselves into squat robots and tried to destroy any life form different from themselves. These villains appeared in the Doctor Who television series. My last boss was a huge Doctor Who fan, I've mentioned this, and she had a Dalek in our office, in our tech office, about this big, remote-controlled, and would say different things such as, exterminate, exterminate. Fat men. After these aliens invaded Earth and stole all of the world's junk food, they took off in search of a giant potato pancake. They appeared in the book Fat Men from Space by Daniel Pinkwater. I know Daniel Pinkwater as a name. Fat Men from Space. What in the heck? Oh, Radioactive Man. No. I don't remember that part, actually. Of the original black and white, but I don't remember a lot of the movie. I remember the kiss climax and everyone screaming. But that's about all I retained. I went through a phase in high school and early college where I was trying to watch a lot of old school black and white horror movies, you know, suspense things. Grinny. This dangerous alien disguised itself as an elderly woman and hypnotized all adult humans. She appeared in the book Grinny by Nicholas Fisk. I wonder how well known these entries are. I would assume, since they're in this database, that people of this time, 1985, would be like, oh yeah, Grinny, how funny. Do we all know? If you know any of these, feel free to call it out. Because that's like, I've never heard of that. Hal. I have deep feelings for Hal. Hal 9000. This very calm computer controlled by Spaceship Discovery, but went berserk when the ship approached Jupiter. Hal appeared in the movies 2001 A Space Odyssey and 2010 The Odyssey Continues. That's not doing Hal a whole lot of justice, folks. Went berserk? Excuse me. I disagree. I'm a Hal defender. It is considered science fiction? This evil ruler of the planet Kamazots had no body. It was a powerful brain that controlled the thoughts and actions of everyone. Oh, on the planet. It appeared in the book A Wrinkle in Time by Madeline L'Engle. Okay, I've read that. Yeah. Yeah, exactly, Musty. I was like, wasn't that a clown? Wasn't that a clown punishing people's children for their crimes, their parents' crimes, or something? Popo, I agree that Hal did nothing wrong. Actually, very much so. Jabba the Hutt. This gigantic reptile-like slug was a galactic gangster who captured Han Solo and imprisoned him in his fortress on Tatooine. He appeared in the movie The Return of the Jedi. Kamazots? Hold up a sec. Holding up. Is it wrong? Did they write the wrong thing? 9 out of 24. We're getting there. Killer Kane. You know that name. Boba Fett captured Solo. Are you all picking apart the database? In the 25th century, he helped evil aliens from Saturn try to invade Earth. He was stopped by the 500-year-old pilot Buck Rogers. His first movie appearance was in the 1936 serial Buck Rogers. Buck Rogers! Jabba just purchased Solo. Yeah, that's funny. I like that hair you're splitting. Klingons! Yeah! Kapla! Gacht! Okay, cruel. These cruel, war-loving aliens tried to conquer the galaxy despite their truce with the United Federation of Planets. Klingons appeared in the TV series Star Trek. Alright, maybe they're going with the original Klingons. There's more nuance there. It's more nuance. Pnowo Ledge. This sinister ruler of the planet Barnacus kidnapped famous scientists and artists and hooked them up to his brain drain machine. This alien appeared in the twisted plot Brain Drain in Microzine number 7. Guess what I'm going to be buying on eBay? That's funny, they put in their own entries. Microzine 7. That sounds awesome. Okay, Martians. Yep. We've seen that one. We don't need to... Hey, let me read you more of the book. How about... I can't help it. The game is making me do it. Masters. These lizard-like aliens ruled the Earth by transforming all humans into mindless zombies when they turned 14. They appear in the books called The Tripods Trilogy by John Christopher. That's interesting. I don't think I've heard of this. Killer Kane was vicious, says Radioactive Man from Mars. Yeah, Radioactive Man from Mars. I mean... I'm just going to go on the record and say that I don't think that all Martians are bad. I have sympathy for your people. You've read it, Popo? I have not. That's cool, though. Was it for kids? Would the aliens from V be in here? What's V? Simon says, I was just reading an article about an ancient Mayan supernatural creature, a man-bat. That was named Kamazots. Oh, there you go! Oh gosh, V is scary, says Specs. Ooh, I don't know what you're all talking about. Ming the Merciless! This emperor of the planet Mongo tried to invade the Earth, but failed. He then convinced the Queen of Mars to aim a death ray at Earth. I don't blame you, Radioactive Man from Mars. I understand there's a difference between a governing body and the citizenry, and that you were not necessarily behind this decision. He appeared in the 1938 movie Flash Gordon's Trip to Mars. Radioactive Man is very excited. Name, the plant. What's the plant in Resident Evil? Like Plant 42, I think? Or Experiment 42? These plant-like aliens lived under the surface of the moon and lured humans to their caves by telling them they would never grow old. They appeared in the book The Lotus Caves by John Christopher. John Christopher again. Microzine really likes John Christopher. Are you all singing the song? Guitar riff. You're all cute. Romulans! These warlike aliens live in the twin star system of Romulus and Remus. A neutral zone separates these stars from Federation space. Romulans appeared in the TV series Star Trek. I love Romulans. Something that, leaning on a key. Key was leaning on a key. Something that I thought was really funny was when I was learning about Star Trek at first, when I started watching the shows, my husband and one of my best friends said the same thing to me when I mentioned Romulans. When I was like, who are the Romulans again? Or, oh, I just learned about the Romulans. Both of them, the first thing they said was, you know, they share a common ancestor with Vulcans. And it was just really funny that they both were like, well, you know, they share a common answer. There was something about that phrase that was so funny that I just thought it was really funny. You know, they share a common ancestor. The Great Gazoo. Selenites 2. In 1901, the scientist Cavour landed on the moon 61 years after explorer Hans Pfaall. And discovered insect-like monsters called Selenites. H.G. Wells wrote about the Selenites in First Man in the Moon, which I read, but I don't remember anything about. Khan-Noonians. Oh, what? Wait a minute. Noonian? Wait a minute. Hold on. In 1990, this warrior tried to take over the Earth and failed. He escaped on a sleeper ship and was awakened years later. He first appeared in the TV series Star Trek. Noonien Singh, no, Soong, is the creator of Data. That's right. What's with the name Noonian popping up in Star Trek all the time? What is that a reference to? I need to know. Oh, thank you, Simon! Simon, solving one of my great questions that I've had for many years. Gene Roddenberry had a roommate named Noonian. He liked that name. Hey, Run Run Rosie, is this like a trivia thing? This is just a database on one of my Microzine discs of, space people. People associated with space. So right now we're looking through a list of villains in this database. So, just a cool little thing included on the disc. We're having a lot of fun with it. You missed my 45-minute breakdown of War of the Worlds. Musty says, is that like the Miyamoto had a landlord named Mario? Basically, lol. Hey, Capsule J. Capsule J says, Noonian is like the Robert of outer space. I'm trying to decide between two names for my child. I'm thinking Christopher or Noonian. What do you think? Do you think there'll be too many Noonians in his class? The Thing. In 1951, this 7-foot humanoid plant was found frozen at the North Pole. Once thawed, it tried to kill the men who discovered it. This alien appeared in the movie The Thing. Did you raid me, Capsule J? I didn't see the notification if you did. You did! With a party of six! Hey everyone, I was so busy reading all this sci-fi stuff. Welcome to the most riveting stream on Twitch right now. We explore my Apple II games and this particular disc, which is Microzine number 13, in addition to having more action-packed games, has this really interesting space-related database, and we're just using search terms to look through it and see what's in there. This was, this disc is from 1985, so it is kind of really interesting to see what they decided to put in here. There are 200 entries, so these are the villains that they found important to include in sci-fi literature. Simon says, Roddenberry lost touch with his friend and had hoped that Khan's similar name might attract his attention and renew his old acquaintance. Oh, that's so sad. That's what you had to do before Facebook. You had to create influential media that reached the nation and name a character after somebody that you missed and then see if they would find your contact info and send you a letter. And everyone who just came in, welcome. We are about to close up, so I'll be pushing you into someone else's stream. We just wanted to get through all of these entries. Triffids, we already read this. New folks, do you remember Triffids? We were having a discussion about how there are a lot of sci-fi fans who don't know what Triffids are, including myself. Unless they hate the character you named after them. Yeah, it's true, Rosie. Tripods, yep. We read about this. Darth Vader, of course. This Jedi Knight turned to the dark side of the Force to conquer the galaxy. His real name was Anakin Skywalker. His son's name was Luke. Spoilers! He appeared in the Star Wars movies. So this is like extra retro Encarta? Yes, Capsule J, exactly. Sorry, everyone. I'm sorry I just ruined that for all of you. However many people are in the chat, forgive me. I didn't know that the database was just going to drop that on us. General Zod. Exiled from the planet Krypton, he came to Earth and used his superpowers for evil. Superman battled him on the streets of Metropolis. This alien appeared in the movie Superman 2. You were told this is a spoiler-free stream. All hail Zod. Let's not see the list again. So, pretty cool. I think that's pretty neat. That was fun. I liked going through that with all of you. I don't know that I would look through this on my own time, but it's a fun conversational jumping point. You know what I mean? Spec says, let me just say, by the way, this has been so fun. I love the tangents and story times and rants. Oh, well, thank you. I'm glad you enjoy it. Thanks to all of you for staying with me through all these tants. What? Tangents and rants. We can now call them tants, if you would like. KeyGlyph's going off on one of her tants again. Hey, Shadow Master. Supposedly Khan helped create the Klingons. We got to learn a little bit about each other, and that's the thing. I do really love getting to know you, and I love that you talk with each other. So that's what this is all about. I really... Tants or tan pants? man, I got some tans on sale today. You gotta go to Kohl's. I really like feeling like we're all just hanging out together. You know, I mention this all the time. We're just in my kitchen, we're hanging out. But I love that feeling that we're just like a bunch of folks who just want to dig through some old electronics again and just kind of reminisce and read books and whatever. Hey, kitty, did you hear that? She's like, you are streaming past time and it's time to feed me. That's my cat. But anyway, so I like that you're in it with me in that sort of homey hangout space. Popo says, look, if they wanted you to get work done, they wouldn't let you be on Twitch. Tis true. Hi, Venus.
Popo says, hi. I heard you. I don't know where you are, though. I don't see her.
But she's being mouthy. All right, so let's see who's online.
Who's online that we can go see? I know the Renaissance is on.
And the Renaissance is starting Cave Story tonight, which I've heard great things about. Hungry's playing Shadowrun on the Super Nintendo blind right now, which is also super cool. So, that's hard to choose. I feel like I haven't raided Hungry in a while. Put them into Shadowrun. I know, it's such a cool game. I've never played it myself, but it's such a cool game. Why don't we do that? Let's keep the sci-fi theme, since we were just going through this entire sci-fi database. Wow them with your knowledge, folks. Just drop in there and be like, what was the name of that villain? I've even forgotten it. Be like, does anyone here know about the Triffids? Thank you, Musty. Yeah, okay, everyone, we're gonna go into Hungry Stream and just start talking about Triffids. Just be like, does anybody know what Triffids are? Sci-fi fans? Anybody? Or just say Triffids a bunch of times. That would be kind of fun. See if we can go into three continuous sci-fi streams in a row. Make it a medley. Yeah, let's do it. So we're gonna go ahead and raid Hungry. Folks, thank you for joining me on another Apple Tuesday. It's so much fun. I enjoy it so much. So I'll see you on Thursday night for some retro thing. I have been streaming No Man's Sky on Mondays, so keep an eye on your notifications if that's your kind of thing. We're doing a permadeath run, and all of you, are allowed to help me kind of collaboratively design my character and name planets and things like that, so we're sort of going on the journey together. It's a mishmash of my thoughts and your thoughts. Speaking of sci-fi. Wait, let me see if I can do this properly. Let me see if I can make this look right. My thoughts to your thoughts. My mind to your mind. We're mind melding. Okay, so gonna push you in. Again, thank you so much. So maybe I'll see you Thursday night, maybe I'll see you Monday night, maybe I'll see you next Tuesday night for more Apple Tuesday stuff. Thank you so much. You guys are the best. I hope you have a lovely night. Have fun in Hungry's stream. I'll be there briefly, and I'll see you over there. So have a good one.